Hello and welcome to a special evening edition of Arts Alive Film, coming from, as you can see, a very busy Odeon, Liverpool 1. My name's Tony Lloyd.
My name is Tony Lindsay, and on tonight's show we have two very different films. Yes. First off, Brooklyn, followed by The Scout's Guide to the Zombie Apocalypse. But tomorrow morning,
what we got?
We have a special interview with our guests, Mark Kermode and Simon Mayo.
That means we stay the night?
We shall see.
Kick a booth. Each week we bring you all of the latest film news.
From interviews with filmmakers and actors, to the new cinema releases.
Is she Ben Nutt? It's impossible to break.
Pretty handy.
I'm a scout.
Like an actual scout?
Yeah.
Nice, thanks.
Thanks.
You know, tonight's the secret party, right? Everybody except the douchebags and the neckerchiefs will be going. This could be the night of our lives.
Okay, well, that's Scout's Guide to the Zombie Apocalypse.
Yes.
Zombie comedy, okay, we've had Zombieland.
We've Zombieland, we've had, of course, Shaun of the Dead, which was excellent.
I think that's the high water mark for me.
I think that is the high water mark. I mean, the whole zombie genre is just... it's been around since the God of Zombies, George A. Romero's
1969's. That's the high watermark. Night of the Living Dead.
But gone Black are these. Gone is the social satire. Gone is the message of doom and gloom. This is about having a party and having fun with the undead. Not sure how that.
But
works.
Shaun of the Dead and Zombieland, though, they had a satirical edge to them,
absolutely,
didn't they?
Yeah.
You know, there was something about them. There was this is three Boy Scouts out for a crazy night on the town.
The usual, want to meet girls, want to have a drink, but they're fighting against being a scout. And that's where the tone of it doesn't really add up, does it?
No.
It tries to be very sweet and innocent one scene, and then others is insane. Now, I like horror, and I like all horror. But this was just, because there's no real context, it's just so over the top. If you're about 12, 13, 15...
Yeah, that's where the humour lies.
If forages into horror, you are going to absolutely love this, because it's going to be shocking for you. Or if you play any of the computer games, like Dead Rising, anything like that...
The supermarket scene. There's the
mixing of weapons in a hardware store. You'll all will have seen it, and it all... The gore is very gory.
Gratuitous.
It is.
It's very infantile. The jokes are not quite sure
on Oddy George's zombies, like he says, that haven't been to the gym. They're a mixture of both. They stagger and then all of a sudden
they can run.
Yeah. A la Danny Boyle.
Christopher Landon is your director. So Christopher B. Landon. Don't know what the B stands for, but I have my suspicions.
Yeah.
He also co-wrote The Thing with Cary Evans and Emi Mokazusi.
Pardon?
Exactly. Okay, Tyle Sheridan is Ben. Logan Miller is Carter Grant. Joey Morgan is Augie. They're the three scouts. Now, in this clip you're about to see, they're about to run into some zombie cats. Take a look at this.
No, I've not seen that before.
What was that?
I think something's in here.
Augie. Augie. What? Don't move.
We did say zombie cats.
Yeah. Meow.
So you've got an idea of what's going on. It's all very broad strokes, isn't it?
Very, very broad strokes. But Cloris Leachman, Mel Gibson's old partner in crime, actually pops up in an extended cameo. But really, it doesn't get much better than that.
I think if you're young and you've not got much, this isn't one of your
It's a Friday night.
Forages.
It's a Friday
with your
night
friends,
movie.
You're gonna love it if you're
our age,
horror veteran onwards.
It's tired. It's a damp squib.
Yeah, It's not going to be for you. But if you're young, go for it. Play Dead Rising with it.
I'm away to America. My sister Rose arranged it.
I can't buy you a future. I can't buy you the kind of life you need.
But you'll come see me there one day. Yes.
Passport, please. Step this way. Next, please.
Brooklyn. How do we describe this term?
Rites of passage. Period drama. Set in, when you say, 1950s?
It's early 1950s. It's a romantic drama. It concerns a young girl, Ellis Lacey, played by Saoirse Ronan, who leaves Ireland, leaves her home, leaves her mother and her sister to find her independence, find her feet. She's sponsored by the priest Father Flood.
And aided by her beloved sister, Rosie, who sends her, tells her she must break free of the small town trappings
the parochial
of Ireland and get out there to a bigger and better life. But does she succeed?
It's a hard one to answer, really, because, well, she, first of all, she comes into the company of Mark Kehoe and her young lady's lodging house.
Julie Walters doing a bit of a turn she might normally do for Victoria Ward.
Yeah, it's a strange one. Have a look at this.
Now, I think this is the first time any girl of mine has ever passed an exam while living here.
Have you told Tony yet, Ailish?
Of course. And is he taking you out to celebrate?
We're going to Coney Island at the weekend.
Oh, boy.
What does that mean?
But do you have a bathing costume?
No, I was going to...
Do you have sunglasses?
No.
You need sunglasses. I read that if you don't have them on the beach this year, people will talk about you. And what exactly will they say, Sheila?
That's the thing, Mrs. Q. You'd never know, because they'd never say it to your face.
Oh, dear God. Diana's right, though, Ailish. You need to think carefully about your costume. It's the most Tony will ever have seen of you, and you don't want to put him off.
You'll have to shave down there. I'll give you a razor that'll do the trick. You're all right there for the moment. And most Italian men appreciate a fuller figure. Watch yourself over the summer. Black's too dark for your pale skin. Let's see you in the green.
Okay, so the director is John Crowley. He's a theatre... film and TV director, but I think he's mostly theatrical, as you can tell from this.
Yeah, I mean, this always sounds so easy for people who are not making the film, because
absolutely.
We do know how hard it is to do that, but at the same time, I think you can see the trappings of a smaller budget.
Yeah, well, it's 10 million. It's BBC Films again.
Yeah, I think we can see that. Considering its title of Brooklyn, we kind of only see a street and the Brooklyn Bridge kind of in the distance.
Well, interestingly enough, they didn't film in America. It was filmed that we have Irish money, the Irish Film Council, and we have Canadian. So there's a bit of green screen in there.
But more seriously than that, which can be forgiven because, you know...
Yeah, absolutely.
The actors...
You cut your cloth accordingly.
Yeah, actors accordingly. I suppose for me, I don't know about yourself, it was more, everything was set out like sketches which engaged you.
Yeah.
And you wanted for each segment fulfilled, but it never got beyond the sketch for me. When I got into real interesting territory, like the young girl with her mother.
Well, look at the young girl with the young American-Italian. A lot of cliches and stereotypes thrown into this, by the way. She falls in love, they marry secretly, and then something happens and she has to go back to Ireland. She goes back to Ireland.
So you've got
she begins to fall in love with an American boy played by Donald Gleeson. So a great dramatic premise. But is it paid off?
Well, that's what you'd have to decide.
I mean, for yourself,
we spoke to, Tony spoke to, we engaged two... women in the audience,
Irish, who lived through this time, they thought it was quite a thing.
They thought they'd caught it, but they were talking about the innocence, and they were talking about, you know, how emotionally closed down people were. So I could see them respond to that, but I think you'll be wanting more.
Surprising as Nick Hornby wrote the script for this, but you know, see what you think.
I think it'll promise a lot, but won't deliver to everyone what you want.
Tony, I want you to know that I don't know what I want you to know.
Okay, so that just about wraps it up for part one.
But in part two, our interview with Mr. Mark Kermode and Mr. Simon Mayo. We shall see you in the morning.
On the morrow.
Hello and welcome back to part two of Art to Life Film. It's interview time, and on our couch this week, two very special guests. First off, the host of Radio 2's Drive Time, Mr. Simon Mayo, and with him, Mr. Mark Kermode, film critic extraordinaire. Guys, welcome to the show.
Hello.
You're here to promote your book, The Movie Doctors.
That's right.
That is true.
Now, first off, some people might know that you work together because, I mean, some may know you, Simon, as the DJ, Mark as the film critic. How did you two first get together?
We've been doing a version of a movie show together for, how long is it now?
A thousand long years.
It's like watching all the Lord of the Rings movies in the director's cuts on an endless cycle. We started working together doing film review stuff when we were both at Radio 1 back in the previous century, genuinely.
In the 90s.
And in which we would do, it was like a little 6-minute review slot, wasn't it?
Well, it was two, that we did it in, we did the whole thing in two bands of 4 minutes. So the first four was all the movie releases.
And then
the second band was all the video releases. So it was in and out very, very quick. Very quick.
And then you went off, I left because I thought I was too old to be at Radio 1. You went off to Radio 5. We started doing the movie show, we picked up doing the movie show there, and it started at an hour, and then over the course of that it developed into 2 hours. And then, because we didn't think that was enough time, we decided to start doing stage shows. So we started, it was about a couple of years ago now, we started doing these shows on stage, which were, you know, talking to an audience about films and the way in which films made them feel and the way in which films made them, you know, feel happy or sad better or something. And as we've done throughout our career, we stole all the audience's best ideas. People turned up and people said, well, how about this and how about that? And we were going, yeah, that's very interesting. Let's just write it in town.
Yeah.
And then we went away and spent a year turning all their ideas into a book. The gag of which being...
Be slightly careful about saying that we've taken all their ideas. There are some original thoughts.
There are some original thoughts.
I was going to offer that up.
We're not going to have to pay back all the royalties.
Yeah, what to whom? Like the audience in general. You can write a check. Dear audience,
so
here is the royalties.
This morphed into the blog then, did it?
It morphed into doing the stage show, and the stage show then morphed into doing the book. And now, of course, the bizarre thing is we're doing a stage show based on the book. So I like to think of it as like Les Miserables. It went from being a book and then to being on the stage and then to being a film. And I think that makes me Russell Crowe, and I think it probably makes you Anne Hathaway.
I'd be very happy with that.
I don't see a problem with Anne Hathaway. It's good.
Okay. So this then,
yes.
Guys, this is the book. This is this year's stocking filler.
It's a big wide stocking.
Admittedly, you need the big wide stockings.
But
it's an enjoyable read. We've both read it.
Absolutely, yeah.
How do you go about working together on something like this?
Well, I think you can tell. We've written it as the Movie Doctors, but my bits are noticeably different to Mark's. Mark's are, you know, profound.
You nearly said academic, and then you drew back.
Well, there is an academic depth to Mark's writing, and if there's anything that's sort of flimsy and throwaway, that's my bit. And if there's anything of substance, then that's Mark's bit.
That's actually not true.
But we divided it up like that. So.
Actually, the way it works is anything that's fun, anything that's about movies that you've actually heard of, anything that makes sense to the normal man's street, that's him. Right. Anything that's whingy, gripey, that's me.
Is that
but
you,
the, but
right.
the way we did it was that we both wrote sections, and then we sent them to each other, to the miracle of email, and then we rewrote each other's sections, and then we sent them back to each other.
That's not exactly true. I wouldn't dare rewrite anything of Mark's.
You did. You did. You would go through and you'd go...
At the beginning.
There was a point, actually, in which one of the things that we would think of doing with the format was actually having... each of us interjecting into the other ones, but it just became like a complete. I mean, there are still sections in there
that
which are just him.
That would be an editorial nightmare.
And actually, we're very, very grateful to the editor for reining it, because there was many times in which the editor did stand over us with a big stick and stop arguing and just finish the thing.
Well, it works.
It works really well.
It's readable. It's enjoyable.
Readable. Can I just say that is the most? That's like the dictionary definition. It's one of those adjectives you see on a poster. Interesting.
It has a cover.
Savagely honest.
I'm very glad that as a book it's actually readable, because unreadable would mean it wasn't.
And
the book.
Pictures are nice. Can I just ask though, for both of you, you know, because it is your career. This is what you do. You know, you love movies. I know. Do you corral a little piece for yourself, or is everything what you like? Is it public? You know, or how do you still enjoy movies as a movie?
Can you go first?
Well, we do. It's very important. It's very important. Always has been to the show that we do very different jobs. I am not a movie critic. Mark is the movie critic. I am a presenter, right? So yeah. I'm a music presenter who has somehow inveigled his way into a movie show. So everything that I do is entirely different. So I will go and see movies if there's a guest attached. So Jennifer Lawrence is going to be on the show next week, so I went to see Hunger Games. If Jennifer Lawrence hadn't been on the show, then I wouldn't have seen it, and Mark will be reviewing it, and I'm just going to go, oh, can you explain this, can you explain that? Mark has to see everything because he's the critic. So I see films in an entirely different way, and it is my job to be the audience, really. So if Mark, as he regularly does, says something that I don't understand, I will go, I don't understand, so you have to explain. But Mark, I mean, so we watch movies in an entirely different way, because I am not a critic. And I think if we were both critics, it would be slightly more difficult.
Well, let's put this in context, Mark. How many films a week do you see?
About 13. I mean, because basically what happens, I mean, as you'll know, the amount of movies that get released in inverted commas in the UK every week has gone up exponentially. It used to be five or six. It used to be national press shows on a Monday and a Tuesday. And I remember very clearly, if there was a third screening on a Tuesday, Alex Walker would be quite cross because he wanted to get home and start writing his
Who's
column.
He?
Alex Walker was, well, he was, you know, the doyen of film criticism, you know, the writer for the Evening Standard for ages and ages, a very feisty and often argumentative character. But nowadays, because there are so many different ways of releasing movies, you know, you can release films digitally, and so there are, if you look at the release, there's 13, 14, 15, sometimes 20 movies released in a week. My feeling is that you have to see as many films as you possibly can to keep on top of that. Yeah. But practically, you can't get in more than 13 movies in a week. And actually, when it comes to doing, for example, the radio show, we'll probably review 7 or 8. The Observer, which I write for, again, it'll be sort of 7 or 8. Then I do blog stuff. But it all comes round in the long run. But there is no hardship in it. Because at the end of the day, what you're doing is being paid to watch films. And although I do moan quite regularly, going, oh, God, such a hard week, you know, I had to watch 4 films today, it's so difficult. You go, yeah, just repeat that sentence back.
Yeah, exactly.
You had to watch 4 films today. Yeah, exactly. How lucky can you be to be in that position?
Absolutely.
And in terms of what Simon was saying before about that, the difference in the relationship is, I think that if this works, and I think for some peculiar reason it does, it's because there's a moderating element, which is, it's one thing trying to see everything and being a film nerd and being a film geek, and that's fine. But actually, if I just talked, people just would turn off. I mean, people find me quite intolerable for very good reasons. And what Simon does is he goes, what? Sorry, who?
Yeah.
How?
Yeah.
That's ridiculous. You know, I can't believe for 1 minute that film you just chose is actually better than Skyfall or whatever. So that's why it works.
Simon's the man in the street almost.
Yes.
Well, it was Johnny Vaughan came up to us at some event and said that my role, he said, you, Simon, you've got a Coric role. And I had to say, and I go, again, I'm sorry, I don't know what you mean. And he said, in Greek tragedy, the role of the chorus, the Greek chorus, was to speak on behalf of the audience. So that, and it's still probably the best description, you know, and that, which is the traditional role of an interviewer, really, is to put the question on behalf of the audience. So.
But then equally, having now done a movie show for the best part of 20 years, actually, when it came to the movie that I was booked, like, for example, there's a whole section in that about 11 reasons why Amadeus will make you a better person. That's nothing to do with me. That's entirely to do with your passion for that film. There's huge sections in there about movies to watch if you're phobic, movies to watch if you're, you know, if you need to be calmed down. All those are you, because the fact of the matter is you don't, I know you like to say, oh, I just see the normal amount of stuff, but you don't do a movie show for 20 years without becoming, what I think's really interesting is that you are becoming a bit nerdy.
No, I'm not.
You are just a little bit.
It's rubbing
off. Rubbing off just a little bit.
No, it's not, actually. I'm just... All I'm saying is my views are uneducated. So I just... They're just the views of someone who goes to see a lot of movies as opposed to someone who knows what
they're saying. That is a lovely mix, though, isn't it? As you say,
I do love that the book nominates Local Hero as one of the best films, because I totally agree.
Actually, funny enough, that was one of the first things that we did agree on.
Because, second best film.
So yeah, Simon's favourite film ever is Amadeus, and mine is The Exorcist, which you couldn't get so further apart. But on our second favourite film, Local Hero, we completely agreed. Absolutely. And I love Local Hero. I mean, I think Bill Forsyth is a real unsung hero of British films.
Totally
I want him to make more movies, and there is every chance that he's going to do that. And you look at Local Hero, I mean, I did a commentary with Bill for the reissue, the BFI reissue of Sinking Feeling and Gregory's Girl, and I'm a huge fan of his. And it's just, you think, it's like one of those people like Terence Davis, poets of cinema, that you just think, and isn't it great that Terence Davis has now done Sunset Song, because Time in the City put him back on the map after 8 years of not making a movie.
Well, I mean, working with two local filmmakers.
Strong films.
You know, well, if that kind of thing can happen, if Terry can have that kind of reinvention, and if, you know, I really hope the same thing happens with Bill Forsyth, and he gets to, because, you know, Davis is firing on all cylinders at the moment. He's doing better work now than he's ever done.
Okay, well, let's just get back to the book to finish off.
Movie
Who
doctors.
Is this aimed at, man? Who would you say this
Who's
is
your
aimed at?
Target audience.
No, we wrote, to be honest with you, we kind of wrote it because it entertained us, but by nature of the fact that it's this time of year, it's, you know, one is not averse to the idea that it might be a Christmas present. However, the nicest thing that's been said about it, there's been a couple of reviews, very nice reviews. I know we always say you should never worry about reviews, and, you know, and anybody who's got any self-respect never cares about reviews, but you do, of course you do. So when, you know, the Reader's Digest are nice, or when, you know, people think we're not, but there's been a couple of nice reviews who've said, actually, it's a pretty good film reference book. And that just makes me feel, oh, that's good, because it's, you know, It's not just us babbling.
Well,
it is solid.
I think there's a...
I'm impressed with the index. I love the index.
He keeps going on about the index.
The index is
really...
It is a good index, isn't it? Because it starts with silent cinema and goes up to, you know...
Let's look at this. It's readable and it's got a good index.
Yeah, exactly.
What more can
you say? The beginning, middle and end. What do we want?
Absolutely fantastic.
I don't suppose there is anyone who's going to pick it up at the beginning and work all the, you know, paid, you know, and end up at the end, because it's a dip-in book.
Yeah.
You know, there's some funny bits, there's some interesting bits, there's
some annoyed bits,
you know, and you can go in all, and you could, it's done as clinics, you know, so there might be some people who go, I've got a headache, I'm going to look up the bits for headache. You know, there are a number of ways of engaging.
That's a really nice way of doing it.
So it's an ordinary film book for ordinary people.
Okay. Well, guys, unfortunately,
with some nerdy, angry bits in it by me.
Yeah. We've run out of time. It's been an absolute pleasure having you here on our couch to speak to you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for coming in.
Thank you for having us.
The movie doctors.
Only one of us is a real doctor. That's me.
No.
He just got given his. I just want to be clear about that.
We're going to kiss it there before
but actually,
right
now, I have a D-lit and it counts.
It doesn't count. They gave it to you. No, it doesn't count.
We'll see you next week on the movie show.
While we mediate this.
We're still going to be here.
You stay. Let's sort this out now.
Good night.